Some say the search for exoplanets is like man's search for the perfect diet and workout. We can try, but things will always prevent us from achieving it. This does not stop physicists, who are famous for searching any and every possible subject. It is this search that led physicists to the discovery of an exoplanet that shouldn't exist. This exoplanet throws massive constraints on our current models of planet formation and changed our vision of planet formation in the universe. I'm going to show you what happened in 2019 when JG3512b, the planet that shouldn't exist, was announced to the world. We need to start with the discovery of the very first exoplanet. Our story starts with two Swiss men on the shore of the charming Swiss lake Léman. Michel Mayor and Didier Queloz were looking for exoplanets. Exoplanets do not emit light, like stars, so they cannot be directly observed using telescopes. The two physicists and many other physicists were looking at ways to indirectly measure their existence. On one day, they left their peaceful homeland to join their colleagues in one of the most beautiful cities in the world, Florence in Italy. On October 6, 1995, they announced one of the biggest discoveries of humanity. Michel Mayor and Didier Queloz had discovered the very first exoplanet ever, and it is called 51 Pegasi b. This phenomenal discovery earned them a Nobel Prize in 2019. The story is amazing and inspiring, but it hides the hard work that is the discovery of an exoplanet in astrophysics. Imagine that you were asked to study the planet Venus with just your eyes, mind, time, and your camera. You can go out every night to take as many pictures as you want and use computers and math to explain what you find out about Venus. It's a very difficult task that we could discuss in an upcoming video if you'd like to learn more about it. If that's the case, please like the video and leave me a comment. I answer everyone and I love to hear from you. Back to you with your camera. Every night you need to set up your camera, you need to give it the best condition for working, you have to make sure there is no light polluting your picture, you need to go out every night to get as much data as possible. Yet in the end, you have a huge number of pictures showing a blurry dot on the screen. And at this point, you need to use the best of mathematics, physics, and logic to infer information from this stack of blurry dots. That's the essence of humans on just one tiny planet in the universe are looking up to the stars. They work hard to make measurements as precise as possible. They work hard to find every single possible bit of information out of the few data they have. They work hard to make all of it fit the theory of the universe. So let's go back to the discovery of the very first exoplanet. Here's how Mayor and Queloz did it. They looked through 15 years of data gathered by the Geneva Observatory to find dwarf stars with a regular radial velocity. According to the calculations, they hoped to detect an exoplanet from a variation in radial velocity of just 13% larger than the precision from the state-of-the-art telescope they were using. Because they were looking for something at the edge of detection possibility, they needed to find stars with a radial velocity as constant as possible to notice slight deviations caused by an exoplanet. A star whose lights oscillate or who is influenced by other stars would just make things too complicated. Their best bet was to find a small star with a large exoplanet orbiting around it and nothing else around it that would lead to a more complicated picture. This way, they would notice a slight displacement of the star from its orbit because of the gravitational pull from the exoplanet. If the pattern was strong enough and regular enough, the team would conclude that an exoplanet exists. They settled on 142 dwarf stars they would investigate in more detail. And among these 142 stars, they found one, 51 Pegasi b, that was particularly promising. It looked like there could have been an exoplanet orbiting it, but the data was too imprecise, and they could be observing us. So they spent the next 18 months collecting data from 51 Pegasi and other stars until they could say for certainty that an exoplanet is orbiting around it. And this exoplanet is called 51 Pegasi b. The letter B is a way for astrophysicists to give meaningful names to the exoplanets. The main star is considered A, even if the A is not explicit. The exoplanets are labeled in order of their discovery as B, C, D, and so on. Our very first exoplanet weighs about half the mass of the Jupiter and is remarkably close to its star. It has an orbital period of just 4.23 days, a short period, but the one that allowed the team to detect 51 Pegasi b. It's the first of the 5,258 exoplanets that have been discovered until now. But our story is only getting more interesting. Now that you understand how the first exoplanet was discovered, we can discuss the discovery of the exoplanet that shouldn't exist. It's called JG3512b, and it is very similar to the very first discovered exoplanet. Both planets are about 0.46 times the mass of Jupiter. Both planets have a radius of 1.27 times larger than the radius of Jupiter. Both planets have therefore a density much lower than Jupiter itself. Astrophysicists think that while Jupiter has a brownish color to our eyes, 51 Pegasi b has more of an orange color, and JG3512b tends towards pink. So you might wonder why we managed to find the first one but not the second one. Well, we need to look at the stars they are orbiting. 51 Pegasi b is visible from Earth when the conditions are good. It has a mass of 1.12 times the mass of the Sun. My own Queloz found the very first exoplanet because 51 Pegasi was orbiting very close to its star and very fast, so it was possible to notice the effect of the planet on the star. JG5512, around which our nearly impossible exoplanet orbits, has a mass of 1/8 of the Sun. The star is only slightly heavier than Jupiter. This difference matters for, since JG3512 is a dwarf star with fusion emitting in its core, and Jupiter is too light to have active core fusion. The exoplanet is about half the mass of its star, which is a ratio we did not expect to observe. And here's why the existence of JG3512b is a surprise. We previously thought that planets are mainly created by the core accretion theory of planet formation. A disk of gas and dust orbits around a star in formation. The particles collide with each other, they end up aggregating because of gravity, and forming separate space objects. In the case of the solar system, the first four planets to be created were Mercury, Venus, the Earth, and Mars. This model, however, cannot explain the existence of JG3512b. The planet is simply too big and would have aggregated in separate bodies or collapsed into its star during its creation. That is, unless another mechanism is at play. The theory of Pebble accretion is a recent model where particles aggregate into small clumps. These clumps are slowed down by surrounding gas, and when they approach larger bodies, become trapped into their orbits. Eventually, they collapse onto them. Sadly, this mechanics cannot explain JG3512b. The astrophysicists built a model showing that following this theory, the exoplanet is very unlikely to occur. The likely mechanism for the creation of JG3512b is called disk instability. And it can occur in disks with a very large mass. If the mass is large enough to create gravitational instability, and if the disk is cooling fast enough, that is, if the particles are losing energy fast enough, they can aggregate into giant planets. JG3512b is a surprise because such a phenomenon is rare in disks with a smaller mass. The mechanism of disk instability works when the self-gravity created by the exoplanet is large enough to overcome the gravity from the star it orbits. In this scenario, the particles would fall onto the exoplanet rather than onto the star, leading to a larger exoplanet. The mechanism of disk instability requires us to reconsider the limits and parameters of our models. So another modern theory called the prompt fragmentation of molecular clouds could explain JG3512b. Molecular clouds and the fragmentation opens up the entire topic of planet formation, which deserves a video of its own. So tell me, would like to know more about it, and I can make a video on this subject. In the meantime, I recommend you check out one of my videos explaining the Bethe theorem. It's a fundamental concept in quantum physics because it shows that reality is different than what we think. It's not just that we are missing some information or some piece of technology. The universe is quantum. So click on the video, learn more about it. My name is Laure, and I'm a physicist and a doctor making positive explanation videos on subjects of physics that I find interesting.